CISS232. Congratulations, you've already made it longer than the person who left before the introduction. What we're going to do today is two things. We're going to go over just sort of the general, how the class runs, that sort of thing, the thing that I do in all my classes. And then we are going to sort of do, and the analogy I give is like, you know, if you go to a musical, a lot of times they have the overture, and it's like a couple snippets, a few bars of some of the main themes in there. So what we're going to do is we're going to hit the main themes of this class. I think it's important for us, as we learn the different pieces, to know how those pieces fit in, as opposed to just studying the pieces individually. So that's why right off the bat, I try to give an overview of everything in this client-server scripting. And I hope that will put things in context as we move forward throughout the class. All right, so let me start taking attendance. I do record this class, by the way. The one thing I will say is that the recordings for this class aren't quite as good as they are for some of my classes, simply because the camera isn't as good. One thing I try to do is, so that way, if I'm talking about something on the screen, that I posted, so you don't have to try to read the code from the screen, and that helps a little bit. But just as an FYI, the idea of recording it, number one, is when I do offer this class online, it's an additional resource, and also if you miss a class or there's something fuzzy that you want to go over again, you have a chance to review it. There is no attendance for this class. How about we do this? Oh, never mind. Attendance. Some of you, and some of you I don't know, so I should be able to use my power of deduction alone. You have pictures next to your name, figure out Hillary, Michael, Timothy Huss. Kenneth Mills, Anthony Phillips, David Toth. All right. I'm assuming you're all somewhat familiar with Canvas. What I will do is I'll talk about the way this course will be structured. It is a good idea to Canvas throughout the classes. You know, check it at least once between classes. What happens sometimes is on occasion there's something that I run into difficulties during class. You know, every once in a while someone will ask a question that kind of throws me for a loop, or I'm having whatever. What I will do is I will post the answer at a later time to Canvas. In addition, if I have any announcements, like were I to have a doctor, whatever, I would also post that to Canvas. So it sort of behooves you to check it periodically to make sure could maybe someone hit the lights, or at least some of the lights? Fine. Your screen will look different than mine, given that we have different roles in the class. The main areas read to you word for word. The modules, which is where most of the course materials are. Questions at grades, you can keep tap on your grades. People, you can, if you need to email someone else in the class, you can, or myself. And then attendance, which is largely for me. Most of the stuff, most of the action is going to take place in modules. The assignments you should be able to see via the modules, and you can also see them via assignments if you want to. The modules are broken down. Where there will be a week, a module for each week. Each show. But you should not be able to see them on yours. All right, so you should only be able to see the first week. Now, one thing that I'm looking at and I'm guessing is when you go to the syllabus, you'll see a whole bunch of assignments that are probably due yesterday or something. The only assignment you need to worry about right now is Lab 1. I thought I had disabled, I didn't. So I'll go back and make sure that those are taken care of. And you'll see any like handouts that I would have, I'll put there. Any examples that we cover in class, I'll put there, as well as the assignment for the week, if there is one. When I have the recordings for the lecture, I will also put those as well. So there'll be a module for each week, in a nutshell. The syllabus. Again, I'm not going to read. I do want to point out some of the highlights of it, though. Up on the top is ways to contact me. And this is important. This is important for two reasons. Number one, ways to contact me. So if you need to contact me, please do so. If you read between the lines, it's also encouraging you to contact me if you have any difficulties. All right. Thing about this class and any other class is things can snowball pretty quick. So if you get a little bit behind and you think that you can sort of catch up, you might be able to do that, but you might need a little bit extra assistance to do that. All right. And really, and so I encourage you to ask questions. This is a small class. So please don't hesitate to ask questions in class, and don't hesitate to contact me out of class. One thing being difficult is, you know, sometimes I try to point you in the right direction of the answer rather than flat out giving you the answer. I think that's partly the job of a teacher, to help you discover the answer. It's great, and this happens a few times a term, and it's always sort of the highlight of the term. Someone will call me over to ask me about a problem that they're having, and, you know, maybe I'll say, like, explain it to me, you know, explain to me what's going on. And in the process of explaining it to me, they sort of realize what the mistake was, and they're able to correct it. That's great when you can discover it on your own. That being said, you are and is over those obstacles, give you what you need, and provide you with some assistance. So if I don't outright answer your question, it's not me giving you a hard time, it's me trying to develop a couple of skills in you. Keep in mind that, you know, if we have an assignment, the job isn't just to get the assignment completed, if that makes sense. The job is to learn the lesson the assignment is trying to teach. And sometimes the lesson you're trying to teach is how to figure out problems. All right, how to figure out when absolutely nothing happens. All right, which is, you know, not an uncommon occurrence in this class. So it's not just being able to write a tip calculator that calculates, you know, 10%, 15%, because there's really probably not a lot of call for that in the world. All right, but to be able to take a problem, try it, fall short, and then make the necessary changes. That's a skill. I mean, that's what programmers do, and so we're going to try to build those skills in you, in addition to building the specific language skills. So I encourage you to contact me. I'll be here 2 hours next week. One thing I do that's a little bit different in this is I make my other labs available to all my students. All right, which means that lecture in a lab. All right, so do all my other classes. I invite students from any of my classes, including my online classes, to come to any of my labs. So we may have people in lab that aren't in this class. You know, if they need the extra, and that's sort of a win-win situation. You know, not everyone can make my office hours. You know, I haven't defined them yet, but when I do define them, I assume that some people won't be able to make them. And that just gives an extra opportunity. Like, if you're already on campus during the day, for example, I have Monday daytime lab, so you can come and sit in on that. Normally, lab to work on stuff. I may have an activity a few times a semester in lab, but for the most part, the labs are your time to work on stuff. And therefore, if things are going just sitting there. Right? Now, if you have questions, I'll certainly be glad to answer them. I even for questions sometimes sit there. All right. So what I do is I invite students from all my other classes, and in that way they can come in and make use of that time. So it's almost like me having extra office hours. If none of the other things work, there's a few other options. You know, I certainly can make other arrangements. Even if I don't have scheduled office hours to be here on campus, we can discuss via online chat within Canvas. We can also discuss via Skype. That would be something that would be good for you to download, is Skype. Because with Skype, one of the nice things with it is even if you're not here, I can view your screen. To an error, instead of you having to describe to me the error, I can actually look at your code and see exactly what's happening. So it's almost as good as being there in other classes, and it worked pretty well. So I invite you to do that sort of as a way. If you read between the lines here, what I'm trying to do, all right, is to remove any possible excuses you have for not asking me questions. And so far, I've had a semester where I'm encouraging people from asking me questions, all right? I doubt this will be the first. So by all means, when you have difficulty, ask the questions. Description in the course outline. This is our focus. Sometimes it's good, again, and I mentioned what we're going to do after the course introduction is sort of give an overview of the technologies. Sometimes it's good to keep your eyes on what it is we intend to get out of this class. And so this is the official course. six people here today. I think there's a couple other who aren't in the room, or maybe one other that's not in the room. All right. Have, that's 16% of the class. All right, you're 16% of the class. If two of you have a question, both teachers has a question, chances are has the same question. So we're up to a third of the class. Something you don't understand, one or two other people have the same question, you're at a third to a half of the class. Why percentage of the class to have a question? To cover the material if it's not connecting with you, you know. If I claim, well, we if statements in JavaScript today, but we really didn't cover it. I may have talked about it, but me talking about it isn't the goal of this class. You learning it and understanding it is. I think you're seeing a common thing. Yes. Campus policies, take a look at. Instructor policies, it's amazing how by students meant to say that I'm very flexible with late assignments. Alright? A lot of students read this and get the exact very rigid as far as, so obviously I'm not very good as a writer. So, with me here explaining it to you, say, hey, I'm fine. I understand if for whatever reason you're late on an individual assignment. You know, life gets in the way. People have other responsibilities, especially at a community college. People work. People have families or family responsibility, and so on. So, if you're late with an assignment, you know, there are instructors that have other policies. Too. There's values of being rigid and saying, no, that's the deadline, you get it, right? And I'm not going to question them. But what works for me is a more flexible, recognizes the other responsibilities you have. Now, here's the thing, though. Be aware that one late assignment is no big deal. A bunch of late assignments is a warning sign. So if you're late on every single assignment, that's a sign that some either you need to talk about a plan to get or you need to devote a little more time to it, or whatever. Alright? The bottom line is, if you're hitting the targets and you're getting the points on that, things are going well. If you're not on a consistent basis, you need to change things. A single late assignment, yeah. Multiple late assignments, I care to the degree that that's a warning sign for problems later on. So don't let that happen and ask questions. Now the other thing, and I think, and this brings on more work for me, so I don't like it for this reason, but it's important to do this. Give you opportunities to rework assignments, all right? You know, first of all, the old saying is you learn from your mistakes. Well, if that was true, the Cleveland Browns would have won a bunch of now, right? So clearly you don't simply learn by making mistakes. You learn when you make mistakes and then figure out what went wrong, and that's where the learning is. So if you did something on a and, you know, you made, okay, everyone makes mistakes. What went wrong, correct it. Alright? If you're not sure what went wrong, talk to me about it. You know, if you're not sure why it is wrong, talk to me about it. And then if you're not sure how to correct it, talk to me about it. The other thing is this removes any sort of, well, I thought you meant such and such. Okay, instead of us bringing our team of lawyers in and arguing semantics and saying the comma there means that you wanted me to do, it's like, nah, just make it work, right? I try to make this as you know, even though these are small exercises, programming projects, I try to make it as realistic as possible. So, when I worked as a software developer, if I did something that I thought was correct, when it was reviewed, it's like, nah, it needs to work like this, you know, okay, yeah, go and fix it, you know. It doesn't simply leave off there. If I made a mistake as a programmer, it's not like they said, okay, well, all right, fine, next project though. No, you got to correct it and move on. So I do give you credit for correcting your stuff. Little different than previous semesters. I changed the grading up a little bit. There'll be a 10-point midterm, a 15-point final, and 75 points worth of homework. And if it points, then it would add up to 75 points for homework. So if there was only 70 points, I would multiply by the up it to 75 points, your homework grade. Here's a schedule, and it's an approximate schedule. Couple mistakes in here. I forgot to change the quizzes in here to reflect that we only have one midterm now instead. But I'll go back and change that later on. Any questions? All these, lab 2 and 3 are a mistake. I'll go and about any of this. All right. Let's get on with the overview of the class then. Let's take it back to CISS 216. Intro to Web Development, where you develop pages in HTML and CSS. Maybe just a little bit of JavaScript. For now, we'll ignore that. Yeah. For now, we'll ignore the little bit of JavaScript. 216. Analogies to HTML and CSS. HTML for the content of the page. So what do I mean by the page? I mean the images, the text, the links, audio, video, anything along the way. HTML is also responsible for what I'll call the structure of the page. I mean, we group things together in tags, and that sort of formed like a structure for the page, organization. So, for example, all our links, not our main link, we put in a nav tag, a structure that says, hey, this section of the page is my navigation. All right? I might have two article tags on my page to say, here's an article, here's an article. I might have a header on my page that says, here's a header. Correspondingly, I have a footer on the page that says, here's a footer. So, oh, that's sort of the logical structure. When I say logical structure, I mean it doesn't really say anything about the appearance of it. I could have a page with a navigation and stretches across the top of the page like that. I could have a page where the navigation goes down this side. I could have a page where the navigation goes down this side, and so on. Navigations, right? So that's a lot what I mean by logical organization of it. Those appear in different ways, right? They look different, and the physical layout is different. And that is of CSS. So the appearance logical structure. So in this example, I have a nav section that contains a bunch of links. All right? That's my content, the bunch of links. My logical organization is they're all grouped together in a nav section. So that's what the HTML would have. All right? The code, it would look something like this. Unordered list, LIA. That's the logical organization. I have a navigation section. And the content is a list of links. Now, that's what's in the HTML. The CSS, of course, determines what it looks like. Where it appears on the page. So, are these links big letters or little letters? Are these links green or white or black or blue or whatever? What font do these links use? Is there a background for these links? Don't change the list of links in a navigation section. So HTML has this part. The physical appearance is in the CSS along with the physical layout. To most of you, but I'm going to limp quickly to the office to grab a marker because these weak markers drive me crazy. Content, then the CSS will have things like the color. They also have the physical. This is a start of things good in web development. Alright? You need to do this to really get the benefit of development. And this goes in a lot of different directions. Let me just hint on a couple directions that this goes into. This allows me very easily to change one without. Alright. So, talking to a guy last night that works. Alright. American Greetings, as much as any company in the world, is on holidays. Right? Because people send cards. Well, next big holiday is what? So, it's very likely that they may want their page to have a Valentine-ish looking theme. So, do they want to go and have to change all of their web pages to look Valentine's-y? No. They want to be able to change a single CSS file or a series of CSS files so that, hey, we can go and we can give it a Valentine's Day look without changing the content. Alright, maybe on the navigation there's little hearts next to the links instead of little Christmas trees or whatever. All right? Looks. That's the e-card link is still an e-card link, right? Another thing is change the layout of our site without affecting the content. A classic example of that, more important, is when you view a page on a mobile device versus on a desktop device. Mobile devices are typically, even with the gigantic, they're still not as for desktop screen. Now, we might want the same content on those pages, but obviously we want it somehow to look different. So, change. Appearance and physical layout will change. You may have a simpler layout, you may have things oriented in a different manner, or whatever that will make sense. So, having a clean separation, it's a start. Alright? These are the basic language pages. Alright? These are the fundamentals of web pages. Now, at the end of CISS 216, and in this class, we started getting into JavaScript will be the next ingredient that we add to this mix. But, for this to work as well as it can, we have to make sure we do a good job with this. Alright. We'll fill in JavaScript in a bit here. Now, let's talk about the kinds of web pages that you did in CISS 216. You created pages with HTML and CSS on your own machine, and you opened them up in a browser, and you looked at them, and you turned them in when they were completed. All right? Now, if you're going to take that project and actually make a website, what would you do? How would you make that a living website? Well, it would need access through the web, so you couldn't leave it on your machine. You need to put it on a machine that was a web server. What does the word server mean? How do I know if a machine's a server? Could we tell by looking at it? Say something is a server, what does that mean? Go ahead.
It receives data, manipulates it, and then sends it out.
Okay. It receives data, manipulates it, and then sends it out. It's a pretty good, at least, starting point for a definition. If I could rephrase it a little bit to make it maybe a little more... Alright? A server receives requests and responds to them. That's probably the most general definition of a server that you can have. All right. Now, in the case of web servers, the kinds of requests receives is a request for. All right. And the response that the server provides is a web page. CSS, JavaScript, and so on. The client is a person who. And receives a response. How do you request a web page? The way to do it would be typing in your browser. Right? All that clients use to connect to this. Alright? So one way that I could request a web page is by typing in www.cnn.com and hitting return. What would happen when I did that, transaction, I type in www.cnn.com and hit return. Well, that requires through the internet. How does it happen? It is magic how it happens. Really, we don't care how it happens in this class, is the bottom line. Somehow it happens. Of the networking classes to explain that aspect of it. Somehow gets routed to the right web server. In this case, CNN's web server. And since all I have is the URL, or the domain, the home page. So the web server will go and take the page, it will find the page, and it will respond back a web page. And web pages, they can contain other things, but for the most part, they consist of C and JavaScript, along with, you know, the respective, etc. I also can request a web page. So if there was a sports section at CNN.com, that would be the same process, except asking for their sports page. So anytime you hear server, you know, restaurant, the client, the customer, asks the server for things, the server responds. Now there's all kinds of responses that the server could give you. I could go to a pizza place and order a steak, and the server might say, I'm sorry, we don't carry that item. So the response isn't always to bring you exactly what you asked. It could be some sort of error message saying, no, we don't do that. All right. But the point is that you should get some response back from the server. Running a web browser, and that client could be running a mobile device or a game console or a laptop or whatever. They make requests. That request gets routed through the internet to the web server, and the web server responds back through the internet with a web page. Now, one thing we don't talk but it bears mentioning are the different protocols involved. Alright? HTTP protocol. If you notice when you request a web page, even if you didn't type it in, that gets typically put in front of your web address. That's the kind of request you're making. That is a request for the web page. Another is another protocol that involves two machines speaking to each other. Actually, every machine on the internet was called an IP address. IP address is a series would be like your home address. It only point, you know, if we say 1005 Road North, Elyria, Ohio, 44035, all right, that only points to one place on Earth, all right? Like IP addresses, only. Now, the address that I gave for a long time ago is an easy. There actually is like a latitude and longitude of Lorraine Community College. What is that? I have no idea. Alright? That's hard to remember. Just like IP addresses are hard to remember. So, CNN has some series of numbers that constitute its IP address. But, I want to look at CNN's webpage. So, That's what I remember. Part of that involves using a DNS or a domain name server that takes those domain names, like CNN.com, and translates them into the IP address so everything goes to the right place. Just like I'm sure on a GPS device, if I say I want directions to 1005 Abbey Road North, I'm sure something translates that into a latitude and longitude so that it can find it. I would guess, anyhow. All right. This is about it for the basic interaction. Back to CISS 216. If you put your web server, say it's a CISS server, the pages that we created that class were called static pages for the most part. Opposed to dynamic. What's a static page? A static page is a web page that doesn't change unless it changes it. And that's exactly what you did in CISS 216. And that's what you do with HTML and CSS. They're responsible for static pages. If I were to go and into the Dropbox for last semester for CISS 216, and I were to pull up everyone's final project in that class, it would look exactly like the day that they turned it in. Someone manually changed it, which I'm sure. So if I have a website, the server is easy. The server's job would be to take those files, those HTML and CSS files, retrieve them, and deliver them. So with static pages, the web server has a very easy job. You request a page, it simply finds the completed page and delivers it to you. It would be like if you go to McDonald's and order a Big Mac, right? You go to McDonald's, they simply turn around, grab from the bin of Big Macs, a completed page, all right? The page has already been finished. Do anything but you. That's what a static page is. And for static pages, you do not need any scripting. You can accomplish static pages with HTML and CSS. But if you think limited, right? If you think of an application that you spend on the web, it's going to be a dynamic page. All right? eBay, Facebook, Amazon, news sites, YouTube. Any of those are dynamic pages. They change. So what I want to conclude class today with is to talk a little bit about dynamic pages. And we'll talk about eBay, and I'm sure you're all, even if you're not a big eBay user, I'm sure you are familiar with the concept. With eBay, you put an item up for auction, and people bid on it. So you might put it out there, and initially the highest bid is $0, because no one's bid on it yet. Well, someone bids $1, and someone bids $5, and someone bids $10. The next person that gets that page, we'll see the current bid. Is there going in and manually every time a bid is placed? It's not. That's ridiculous. That is not feasible in the least. So therefore, these pages are created in a different manner. These pages are dynamic pages. Pages are scripts, or to give the food analogy again, recipes. They're instructions for creating a web page. And typically, with things such as eBay, etc., this involves connections. So now there's work to do. The web server has to grab finished pages. The web server grabs the recipe, the instructions of how. Then it does, for example, in the case of eBay, got the product description, the images of the product, the description, and so on. Look up the. Then takes all that information, assembles a web page, and delivers that web page to the client. So this would be more. Subway in ordering a sandwich. Subway in order a sandwich, possible variation of all the different combinations of bread and vegetables and all that waiting for you. That would be ridiculous if that would work. Instead, what they have is they have a server, the sandwich engineer or whatever they call them, who knows the recipe for making a sandwich. And who gets input from you and gets input from the ingredients and assembles a sandwich for you on the spot and delivers that to you. That's what server-side scripting does. Now here's the key point that I'll conclude today with. Important thing to keep in mind, when it's done, static page or dynamic page, this is what gets right? Both a customer that goes to McDonald's and a customer that goes to Subway wants a sandwich. Alright? So when they leave, they should have a sandwich. Recipe. Can't eat the sandwich. Alright? Now, the difference is the manner in which that sandwich is created. Either it's created and it's just sitting out there waiting for someone to ask for it, or the ingredients for it are out there, and that sandwich is created on the fly. When you do that, then, you have the ability to change that based on any number of factors. So in the example of eBay, if I request an item today, I'll see the current price as of now. If you were to go and view it tomorrow, you'd see the current price then. All right, so we would each see maybe different information depending on when we look between now and then. Analogy of this model by talking about dynamic pages, talking about how client-side fits into the equation, talking about Ajax, which is sort of the last topic of this section. Talk about Ajax and what it provides. All right, your first lab is out there. Your first lab is simply a web page that overviews the technology in this class. So you'll create simply a static web page. We will use this to build on for future assignments.